And we're back, everybody. Game two between Avengers and the Fantastic Five. Avengers falling in game one pretty convincingly, 15-minute defeat. And we're gonna see if they can bounce back here. It is single elimination here in the Style Ladder I League Invitational, European qualifier to see who's gonna go to Kiev in April, compete for $100,000 with the invited teams. God's showing me a scant. How are we feeling about game number two? No Nature's Prophet
Well,
this time.
that's what I was gonna say. There's some reaction at least from Avengers. We did talk a lot about how something very important in analyzing how that game went is that Avengers had a lot of heroes that couldn't have an impact early on. Fantastic Five had a lot of heroes that could have that impact, and the game just kind of played out accordingly. And the Nature's Prophet was one of those heroes. I think Chen, which y'all's first pick this game, is a similar kind of hero though, unfortunately. So the dynamic already starts to unfold in a similar way. And the key for me is for Avengers to make sure that their draft, their picks, can interact, especially their support picks and their offlaner, because honestly, the job of the two main cores is mostly to farm right at the beginning. But especially those other three heroes need to be heroes that can interact in a positive way with Fantastic Five's heroes this game.
Yeah, and I think that's the key point. It's not just to focus, like, you can't just ban out Fantastic Five series. You need to pick around a lineup that's going to play into them and perform better. So we'll see what that's going to be here as far as the opener goes for Avengers. Last time around, it was the Witch Doctor Beastmaster. Was Beastmaster first stage last time with the Witch Doctor? I can't.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's what the two picks were. And Witch Doctor, I mean, is an appealing pick here. Again, it's a very strong support here. It works well against the Chen, can get those casts bouncing around. But the concern in that game is that Witch Doctor, you notice a weakness of the hero is that it's not really your jump around the lanes kind of hero. It can be in a very static game, it can move around and gank, but it's really a hero that's meant to be a lane dominator. It's meant to just like give one lane a really great time, and that might be a reason that they'd think twice about picking it this time.
Well, a very different approach. And what is a hero Black has played a lot of, even when he was playing the carry role, Invoker gets picked up. And this is, I would say, one of his probably more comfortable heroes right now.
It is, but again, when we've seen Black play Invoker, as you were saying, he was playing it in the carry role and he was playing it mostly in the safe lane. And I feel like it is different playing Invoker in the safe lane to playing the mid lane. Safe lane Invokers, are completely unchallenged always, and the game starts the way they want it to. And if he's in the mid lane, I mean, I'm not doubting his ability to play the hero, but I don't know if we've seen him tested on the heroes and like playing it under pressure in that lane stage. So it might be somewhat of a new challenge. And they do pick up the Tusk, which is definitely going to reinforce that the mid lane early on. And it also takes away the Tusk from Fantastic Five. It was one of their key pieces last
Yeah,
game.
it was a last. I think it was a fifth pick though. So, despite it being a key piece in some ways, I don't feel like it was something which they were necessarily too reliant on based on where they placed in the draft. But Odie picked up as a response for Fantastic Five. Not really. I feel like Odie and Invoker, as far as a mid matchup goes, not really favored so much either way. Odie's pretty good at dealing with Forged Spirits because of the orb, but at the same time, you don't want to get too close to an Invoker because of his firepower.
I think the matchup favors Odie if you've got the right kind of supports that can threaten coming in. It's where heroes like Tusk come in. I feel like if they leave the Tusk in there, they might have to balance because Tusk is one of the better heroes at Astral into Shards and suddenly Invoker dies. There's the Mirana that works quite well. Sometimes your Forge Spirit can block the arrow for you. But actually, even the Chen, even just like sending some Chen creeps with the OD, could end up dominating the Invoker. That's a possibility.
All right, well, see what the next couple of bans going to be. Jonas's Brood gets removed from the pool. Hero he's played a lot back in the NIP days and since then. So Void getting taken out by Avengers, and we'll see what. I mean, Fantastic Five with the Chen OD haven't really revealed how fast paced they want to play, but pretty much almost entirely based on last game. Like, you've got to play like a Voss. You want to be kind of setting a fast tempo, applying pressure, and you're versing an Invoker in the mid lane. So Black, who's known more for playing the Exord Invoker, that's something which is very vulnerable and very easy to exploit by playing aggressive.
Yeah, and I think Fantastic Five, if you look at their two offlane bans together, the Darkseer and the Brood, they communicate something kind of similar. They're both offlaners that are quite difficult to shut down, and they're also both offlaners that, in different ways, but they both make it difficult for you to push. Broodmother because it's applying pressure with the split push, and Darkseer because it threatens that kind of five man. So I think in both regards, Fantastic Five know that because they have a Chen, they're only gonna have one support in their safe lane, so they don't want the offlaner to be that difficult to deal with. And also because they have a chain, they want to be able to push and don't want heroes that cause trouble for pushing. So yeah. I think it's really good bans to protect their first pick chain.
And it also means they could, yeah, they can run those safe lane heroes for Havas, which maybe like would struggle in a bit of like if you're versus, well, anyone's going to struggle versus a Darkseer Brood, but like you can't, once you see a Darkseer, you're almost forced into picking something like a Gyro or Jug, something that can actually compete in the lane. But it leaves the pool of safe laners for Havas much more open.
Yeah, on the other hand, the Avengers second phase bans are Void and Batrider, and for me that's really about, they don't want there to be those setups for the OD. We've seen OD be most successful, I think, in the current patch, when it's combined with some kind of control which kind of just locks things down and allows it to right click. So those are two very big offlaners that both have that kind of impact on the game. And incidentally, what that means is that both teams have banned a lot of offlaners, and we might see some kind of unusual offlaners in this game. I mean, the Beastmaster is still around. I'm not sure what else of the sort of main offlaner pool is actually still in there.
Yeah. Scratching my head a bit here. Yeah, Beastmaster, the big one. Other than that, I mean, Legion Commander, a big hero that Jonas has played a lot of, but definitely not like a common offlaner to see nowadays. CIS teams have always loved to run the Spirit Breaker, even in the offlane. So
we saw Wings pick up the offlane clock again.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Kind of throwback to the past.
Mm-hmm. Well, clock was traditionally picked quite a bit against Gyrocopter because you hit that blade mail timing and you can just go in a gyro and he doesn't want to throw a Rocket Barrage cooldown because he kind of blows himself up. Similarly, it's a bit of a rough hero for Invoke. I could see that being a pick for Fantastic Five. More so than Avengers here, but they're going to grab the Beastmaster, which was kind of the top tier offlaner left in the pool, so to speak.
Yeah, I mean, Avengers already have a Tusk. If they really want, that can be their offlaner, but that it's not that compelling to me at the moment. I feel like it's right for Tusk to be a support in the current meta game. I could be talking absolute nonsense, but it just feels like exactly what we're talking about before. For if you pick Tusk as an offlaner, it's not threatening to like get Iron Talon and get super farmed, so it's got to have some impact early on, but then it's having not too much more of an impact than what a support Tusk would, but you picked it as an offlane. That's what I feel.
Yeah. They pick up Disruptor, so it does still leave the Tusk going, but the other offlane which came to mind is still the Earthshaker, which is still in the pool, because I don't think you're gonna be able to contest the offlane. So like getting a hero in the offlane that can guarantee some experience, like an Earthshaker, you just fissure block the creep wave, and then you've got a setup for the Invoker, the Gyrocopter could be a decent option as well.
Yeah, I think that would work here. It's also really nice to have the Earthshaker just against the, you know, the big group up and push kind of strategy. I wonder if Avengers would consider actually, if I'm Avengers, I might consider moving the Tusk to offlane just because I think that getting a support Ancient Apparition could be really good for them here against, you know, the Chen and the Juggernaut together. Also just to give them that much more damage with, you know, they're going to have the Forge Spirits, they're gonna have the Gyrocopters, Flak, and if you add Chilling Touch, that suddenly is like enormous damage. So
I mean, to that extent of running a Tusk as a core, do you even consider an aggro tri-lane with Gyro Disruptor? Because you are versing a Chen who's gonna be mostly in the jungle, or is that like a too risky of an option?
Actually, I think that's a good idea. I think that's something I could see them doing, and it probably depends on what support Fantastic Five gets. But they ban the Tide, so they are expecting the offlaner still to come out.
Oh, yeah. Forgot about the Tide. He's been around for a while. But yeah, so we'll see what Avengers get now. And they could even aggro trialing with the Tusk and get, because my main concern with like the aggro trialing is that Tusk doesn't match up great against Beastmaster 1v1 necessarily, and the aggro trialing isn't necessarily going to crush the lane. Yeah, there's a Chen in the jungle, but Jug can at least hold his own to some extent. Shouldn't be going down.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind seeing something like a Klinx, like a strong safe laner, just into that aggressive laner we've been describing. I feel like if you have a Gyrocopter and decent supports and the enemy team's running a jungler, it's always a consideration maybe going aggressive, but they actually picked the Phoenix, which almost certainly will just be the offlaner. It's very surprising to me because I think Juggernaut's considered to be one of the better heroes against Phoenix.
Yeah, well, against the Egg specifically, but... Lion gets picked up, so there's a response. They get some disable. I'm curious they ban the Venge, because like if you're picking like a Phoenix last, you don't really think, oh, Venge is going to be a hero that's problematic for Phoenix to deal with in lane. He's maybe a bit annoying for the zone, like the early zoning with like the Howl of Terror plus right clicks with a low base armor Phoenix, but like a Lion, Silencer type hero are typically much more problematic.
I think it's the ban is more bots. They're scared of bots. The game gets carried away before they even end it, like last game. And Venge and Beastmaster and Chen is kind of like it's one of
Oh
those
yeah.
lineups where, all of a sudden you can't deal with their five man. But it is a lion in the end as the last pick. And I mean, I actually think even without the Venge, Fantastic Five, like I think people often underestimate the value that OD gives to group up and as five early on. Just with the aura, so you can spam everything, and obviously the chunking hits when they
Yeah.
defend.
And you've got
So
heroes
it.
like Jug who will quickly run out of mana. Like this is a hero who often struggles to sustain himself when he's fighting early. You TP and there's 75 mana gone, your Omni Slash is 200. You're unlikely to be able to use a Blade Fury and a Healing Ward, so having an OD makes a big difference for Jug.
So I think again, this game is going to be. It could be very much defined in the first 5, 10 minutes. Just like. What happens in the lanes?
And you're looking at
Because
like
I.
the Chen to be like the big kind of player there as far as the Chen and the Tusk or
Yeah, well, mostly the Chen, actually. I would see it as like advantage Chen. We assume Chen's going to get a lot done, and then we see, what can the Tusk do? What can the Disruptor do? I mean, the Lion's not going to present that much of a threat that early on. I think it's possible for Lion to, be involved in the occasional gank or kill in lane, but it's really just does the Chen get too much done? Are they able to get equivalent value to the Chen? Can they control the Chen's impact? But I think if the Chen does get too much done, we might see a kind of similar story to last game, despite the fact that Avengers have adjusted their draft substantially to avoid that kind of scenario.
early ward placed by a TPing Disruptor, pinged out by a lot of the Avengers team, like, this is where we want the ward. It helps kind of apply pressure on this mid lane, also keep tabs of where the Chen is. As far as the vision it provides, it sees a little bit towards the main side of the Radiant Jungle, but also into this mid lane camp as well. So, see what Avengers want to get done here. They also can look to set up for this level 1 rune fight if they so choose, but it seems like Invoker just going to be heading top and not looking to fight level 1.
It's kind of interesting, the new spring cleaning change where you place a ward and it shows you the actual boxes of the camps, but we don't
Yes.
see that as observers. So I'm like, does this ward block this camp? Is that part
I
of what
remember
they
seeing, I
placed?
think it was when I was seeing one of Toby's casts when he was like showing a ward that there was a way you could see the camps. I'm not sure how that's
Oh,
done.
there's like a way you can bind it to. I think there's a way you can bind it to like when you press Alt or something,
Oh,
but I'm
okay. Gotcha.
not completely sure what it
Yeah,
is.
Let me know, guys. Like, tweet at me if there's a way as observers to see where those spawn boxes are for the camps. But yeah, I'm not entirely sure. I'm pretty sure I'm not 100% sure, but I remember watching. I think it was Toby or one of the casts for one of the tournaments where you could see it. But for now, whoop, Ghostick. Oh yeah, for a second he messed up the block in the top lane, but he managed to get the range creep out in front before the Bora expires. But that's going to be dealt with. Nice play by Disruptor. He's there, tanks a few hits, gets the melee in front. So I'm going to give Beastmaster a rough time as far as getting experience and farm out of this lane goes.
And it's actually this is it's interesting. I've seen this matchup a few times recently, a zoning Disruptor against the offlane Beastmaster, and it's normally something that the what you'll see the disrupt like the Beastmaster can get bullied quite a lot until he has to solve, and then usually at that stage the Disruptor's out of mana by the time the Beastmaster solves. That's kind of his job. Like he wants Disruptor to use all of his mana pool to get rid of the solve, and then the Beastmaster is actually okay in the lane if that's what happens.
Well, two clarities, to some extent, check understanding that maybe that's what the Beastmaster wants and preparing to have a decent amount of sustain to counteract that.
Yeah, it's gonna definitely do a lot of work in this lane, I agree.
A lot of it comes down to some of the plays available. Like, if Beastmaster can cancel the clarities using the boar and prevent that from happening. But for now, the lane looking to push out a little bit, but nice little side pull here. Ghostick, oh, immediately loses Hawk. They're doing a great job of dealing with this Beastmaster, who has hit level 2, but realistically, not getting much out of this lane considering it is a dual lane.
And we talked about the Chen and the Tusk, and they're both busy harassing the mid lane at the same time. It was first the Chen rotation and then Invoker. Tusk came in to try and help, and yeah, it's so I guess you could say that's neutralized, except that there was never really any plan to make a kill there by the Chen and the OD. It was just harassment, I think. We do see that the Chen took a level of penitence early on, which is something that we've seen occasionally recently, but still definitely not the main Chen build.
The more I've seen it, the more I've started to like it, and like the few times I'll play Chen, it's like it feels a lot easier to find some of those kills. So, bottom lane, speaking of kills, they're looking for Yone here. His dive's still on cooldown, and with the Impale, Hex, it's enough slow, Jonas. 2 seconds, 1 second. He goes down. That was very close to having a dive, but perfectly timed aggression from Fantastic Five secures that kill in mid lane. There's a snowball coming in onto BZZ. The Ice Shards block, and Black gets banished up. Does not have Sunstrike invoked. He has the two other spells. We'll have to wait some time before he can get this kill, but the slow's coming out. He pops a Fairy Fire, the Orb of Venom. He gets it reproc on. He's going to have to go for the suicide, it looks like, and BZZ denies himself. Nicely played. Although it is still a small victory for Avengers as far as the mid lane's concerned, taking the OD out, even if they didn't get credited the kill.
Looks like Fantastic Five just want to go for the tier 1 fights right now.
Well, they're going for another kill on Jonas, so they're trying to force out the dive, it looks like. Iron Man just looking to right-click Jonas away. He holds onto it, pops the... Oh, Salve gets cancelled. Whoopsie-daisy. Iron Man. He was the player in game 1, or the MVP, I want to say, and here he is already. Applying a lot of pressure in the early game here, making some nice little individual plays and keeping Jonas away from this tier 1 tower.
Again, the Tusk is going to come across and try and help where the chain is having its influence, but in this case it's going to be a lot more difficult, I think. You can throw an Ice Shards or something, slow down the push, but I think this tower's going down one way or another.
Yeah, I mean, they resummon the skeletons. They lose one of the Dark Troll summoners, but they really want to commit to this one. Havas has the Blade Fury if he needs to pop it just for a bit of immunity, but they actually don't quite get the tower, and they will be forced back a little bit. Boogie going in for the deny. I can't imagine they're going to allow this one to happen, and... Oh, Dark Troll summon, he gets it! Yo! Last hits the tower with the troll, and... Not, that was always going to be... I feel like that should not have been a denied tower to begin with, but it was very close to being a denied tower with Fantastic Five backing off it.
Yeah,
an opportunity.
Leaving it very close, just sending in the troll to get the last hit to me, and it's like... I thought their heroes would commit and just kind of scare them off.
It's like, it's a Tusk Phoenix, a very low HP Phoenix. Like, very if that tower had been denied, I would have considered a mistake for Tans. It was a kind of a good play from Yell, but he shouldn't have had to make a big play to get the tower last hit.
Yeah. I agree with that.
Hey, they get it, though, so...
Beastmaster's got Iron Talon, he's gone back to farming jungle, but it's allowed Disruptor to go off the lane also a little bit, and was around the mid lane hoping for a kill attempt, but...
Yeah. And that's the one thing where they're probably scared to if that tower bottom is that there is an Invoker Sunstrike, so that global nuke presence is always going to be problematic. Getting towards the mid lane, Centaur stun will follow up the OD banish, but Yol in trouble here. Gets kept alive by an Impale for now. We're going to walk into that Sunstrike. Black lands it and gets himself Avengers' first kill of the game.
It's the very best time to Sunstrike people running away, actually. When they're like scared they're being chased and they're trying to run the most possible efficient way to gain distance, then you almost always hit those Sunstrikes.
Yeah. Not the biggest loss for Avengers. I mean, for Fantastic Five. I mean, yeah, it's a kill going Invoker's way, but they were... kind of forcing Avengers to keep a lot of heroes around this mid lane.
Disruptor's gonna die.
Yeah, there's a rotation. Yep, and OD as well, so no way out of the Shaq here. We'll push Beastmaster away a little bit, but he's still even in experience range for the kill.
That's gonna... I mean, they had a... the Radiant side had a ward on the cliff and a hawk. It was like, they could see absolutely everything.
Jonas, dive forward. He's going aggressive on y'all. Ballsy play, but he's got rotations coming in again. The Sunstrike gonna land. Ice Shards, not the best, but the Snowball will secure it. Boogie, what's the play here? Centaur stun, no mana for it. Dark Troll also does not have an ensnare. They'll lose one Chen crew, possibly both here. Is the OD banish not gonna set anything up? BZZ all alone here in the mid lane. So.
Yeah, so we're already seeing a very dramatic difference from last game. Both teams are kind of contesting the early game, the lane stage, instead of just one team.
Iron Man finds Jonas, who does not have a dive for now, but won't chase despite having a haste rune, not really maybe knowing the cooldown there. Also, even if he didn't have the dive, it would have been a hard kill.
So, there's going to be pressure on that top lane, trying to even out the...
I mean, again, Disruptor just rotating in. He's got to imagine that there's vision here once more. He fell for this one once, but knowing that he's got a decent amount of support and teammates here in the top lane.
And this is, I really like this, the Juggernaut comes into the top lane. I think that the recognition that keeping your tier 1 alive when you've killed their tier 1 on the other side of the map is, it's really, really important. It's something that's maybe not spoken about enough, and I think it, I don't know if it's become more important recently or if it's just something a team's prioritized more recently, but if you see a team get a 2 or 3 tier 1 tower advantage, they almost always win the mid game because the access it gives you to the map, the availability of smoke gangs, those sorts of things. Yeah.
And you can roam, move around the map a lot easier because of like all the different TP points.
Yeah, exactly. Mid lane, there's a kill attempt on OD, but this is going to be very difficult. And OD turns it around, kills the Tusk.
Yep. And not just the Tusk, Disruptor as well, going to be left for last with the Banish and taken out by the Chen. So, nice couple of kills, and similar to last game, Fantastic Five just seem to always have the numbers they need in this mid lane. Yeah, there's been much, much better job by Avengers to apply pressure and fight early on, but Fantastic Five just really kind of finding the right timings and opportunities when they need to here.
Yeah, and in this top lane in the meantime, Avengers have committed a lot of heroes mid, the Gyrocopters alone, and even though Gyrocopters had complete free farm and farming really well so far all game, can't really handle the Juggernauts, never mind the Beastmaster being there. I feel like, yeah, Solitude has to commit the ulti to push them off, and now the ulti's used, and Solitude's gonna need backup from his teammates, because he definitely can't hold this on his own.
I'm looking at Ghostsick for a second, like, well, he's not got Roar, because so they're not gonna get this tower, but Havos actually has a Mengo, so we could see a Mengo throwing Ghostsick's way if it could secure a kill here, and Havos has mana either for an Omni Slash or a, actually no, now both spells with the level 7, so very difficult defense here in the top lane. And I'm sure Ghostsick is gonna get caught out here, pulled back in by the Glimpse. The Omni Slash goes through, takes up Disruptor, but it's gonna be a 1-for-1 trade. No opportunity to go for a Roar. Havos keeping his Mengos to himself.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I wonder if that's something that crossed their minds. Like, they probably just didn't think of it.
I think it must, because I'm sure, like, the communication there has gotta be Beastmaster saying, like, hey, if they come, I don't have mana for Roar. Because, like, that's like a key part of that push there, Havos, whether or not you have Roar. So Havos may have probably said, hey, if something happens, I'll Mengo you, but there was no, like, preemptive Mengo.
Yeah, I guess in the way he got glimpsed in the end, it wouldn't have mattered if he had Mengo.
No,
or
absolutely. Probably leaving it for, like, the clutch play. It's like, last second Mengo, get a Roar off, but no opportunity available. Top tier on tower very low here, but Ghostsick still gonna hold his ground, keep this one alive. Solitude looking to commit, knowing that Fantastic Five are in the mid lane, and see if Beastmaster can get deny on this one. They pop the Glyph, Ghostsick pushes forward, and it will be denied tower, it looks like, coming out for the Beastmaster here. Solitude.
Yeah, Solitude has to respect the Roar and the possibility of another TP, so exactly. He can't contest that.
Good discipline from Solitude, but and ultimately they get the tier 1 tower, which does take away some of those access points from Fantastic Five. Helps protect your own jungle a little bit better as far as Fantastic Five being able to easily rotate through from the top lane.
Pre 10 minute blink dagger on Lan. RMN just like having the series of his life.
He's been phenomenal. Even like mid lane, that impale onto Invoker where he almost manages to save Yol from the Chen. Like, he's made a lot of big plays in both these games.
I can 100% guarantee that the first time he blinks in, Avengers are going to be surprised. Like, there's no way that they expect to be facing a blink dagger online yet.
Yeah.
So we just have to see if he can make a kill here with it.
Yeah, it's going to be possibly on the Invoker. Iron Man in position. He's got some backup black, but it's not that nearby. Yeah. They're there, but they're far enough away. They may be able to kill black before a reaction can come. Jonas, he actually may be on the receiving end. Iron Man scouts him out. Now the blink dagger's been seen. Okay. Avengers is going to be like, okay, Lion's going to blink now, at least we know it, but the bad news is he's got a blink. Finger of Death, Iron Man, he's going to go for the Impale, he's already used the Finger, it's on cooldown, BZZ, going to get turned around, has the OD ultimate, throws it out, takes away a lot of the mana the Avengers side, and Havos TP, Blade Fury through, gets just the one, looks like Boogie. We'll get away back to safety for now, but Iron Man can chase, and without the mana for a TP, Iron Man may be able to find him here. He's going to be probably getting word. Odie's like, dude, this guy's got no mana. You can find him. You can kill him. And yep, you betcha. Boogie locked in place. Leaves the kill for Havos. And Havos now drums complete. Phase boots level 8. Going very aggressive with the build. Max out Blade Theory. Now starting to level up the healing ward. Pressure is going to continue to surmount here for Fantastic Five.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, okay, sure, you got a fast blink, but it was Brown Boots blink. But the amount of gold he has now, RMN could just go back for, like, towards the Etherlands or by the Tranquil Boots. And It's good that RMN caught out the Phoenix that controlled him, but it's also, I think, maybe a misplay from Jonas. It's something you have to keep in mind when you have Phoenix. It's almost like playing a quap ult. Voss is gonna run forward. And maybe there's gonna be a bit of a fight.
Yeah, they're gonna catch out Jonas again, and RMN this time with the finger. You control that Phoenix, you take away the supernova, and suddenly Avengers' ability to teamfight is very limited. You've got a Gyrocopter who wants to fight, but Gyrocopter alone, he needs that defensive kind of ultimate from the Phoenix supernova.
That's the point I want to make at the mid fights, is that Jonas actually dived forward and didn't get his ulti off because Lion just controlled him. It's something you have to always, like, you have to always keep in mind as a Phoenix player. Like, a lot of the time you have to dive in and just immediately egg. You can't, like, try and be super efficient with it, because if as soon as you get hexed, then you're gonna die before you even get your egg off, and it's very, very costly to the team for Phoenix to dive in and get controlled before ulting.
Well, some chase coming out, they're possibly trying to get vision for a glimpse here, but teamfight I don't think would necessarily suit Avengers right now. There is no cooldown. They do have the supernova still available, looking to perhaps find an opportunity to use it, but not going to happen for the time being, and it's still going to be Fantastic Five. They don't have the most farmed heroes in the game. That title belongs to the Gyrocopter, and even the Invoker outfarming OD, but looking at the distribution, all five Fantastic Five heroes in the seven top farmed heroes of the game, so much better farm distribution, and they've been taking towers, they've been looking to apply a lot more pressure, and they do lead by 5,000 overall net worth.
Yep, and it's starting to show. Interesting that RMN's not bought a Staff of Wizardry, so I guess going for a... Well, and a Null Talisman.
Whoa.
What do you think that suggests?
Well, it suggests Dagon, but...
Yeah.
Is that the build?
Because I was going to say he's going for 4 Staff and not Edelins, and then I saw the Null, and I was like, maybe Dagon is...
Casual stats, you know? I'd be very surprised by a Dagon build, but... I mean, against heroes like Phoenix, you want to burst down, it does give you that, like, when Finger's got a long cooldown, so... Supernova goes in, but Soltooth's already dead, and Havos can hit the egg through the Blade Fury. Yol shows up without any fire spirits on himself. Iron Man gets away from the Sunstrike, which I don't think would have killed him anyways. 350 damage, he had, 400 HP, so... It was fine regardless.
I just want to... I mean, I think it's... For a guy who goes Brown Boots into Blink, I think it's a bit suspicious to then go back for Null for the stats.
Yes.
So, I sort of think he is going Dagon. I don't, like... Otherwise, he would just go straight into his 4 staff.
No, I think it looks highly possible. What do you think? What are the merits of Dagon here? Like, why Dagon?
I mean, it's just more burst power. It almost guarantees that he can control the Phoenix on his own.
Yep.
You know, just get off that heck. He can burst it down on his own. The Phoenix is gonna die, and no one else is gonna have to even do anything, which will probably be pretty big for those fights.
He could theoretically almost solo kill anyone. Gyrocopter may become a bit of a struggle with the Sanj magic wand, but like Finger Dagon. A lot of burst damage, that goes without saying.
Yeah, being able to get things done on your own is pretty cool. I mean, I suppose the Null could be building into a Veil later, and then it wouldn't just be like casual stats Null, but
Fantastic Five. They're going in for the Roche, but some great patience. They get out of the Roche and hit the Finger! Oh, Tusk, goodbye. Lion finds him, snipes him down. Iron Man gonna deal with the Ford Spirits, and it looks like, no way for Shaq to get out of this one. He'll get Hex taken out by the Jug. And they can go back into the Roshan pit. Great awareness from Fantastic Five. They start Roche, get down to half HP, quickly realize that, hey, Avengers aren't showing at any of these lanes. The biggest tell is this top lane. There was a big creep wave pushing up, not being farmed. When that top lane, which is probably the safest farm on the map, isn't being taken by Avengers, Fantastic Five just knew. Let's get out of the Roche pit, win the fight, then take Roche.
Yeah, I think this Avengers team just lacks direction, honestly. And I think they react to the first game by, oh, Lion might go down here. There's a cooldown available, it should be a kill.
Yeah. Unless he can somehow find a blink out, but the damage over time is going to be too much. Sunstrike will secure the kill.
So, it's something small, but it's... I just feel like the general trend across these games, there's more direction for Fantastic Five. They know what they want to do, and Avengers recognize, like, the very worst thing about last game was that they weren't even playing in the early game. And so they like, got that amount of direction in their draft this game. They want to contest the lane stage right at the beginning. But it felt like after that, after the first 5 minutes where they like traded blows, they still kind of lacked that sense of direction. Not really sure what their timings were, you know, where their draft wanted to go, when they wanted to push, when they wanted to fight, when they wanted to, I don't know, go for smoke gank. And I think that lack of direction is something that we do often see with a newly formed team.
Yeah.
But it's unfortunate for them because this is like single elimination brackets and they're against the ropes now already in game two.
Oh, Lions, he's got it. He's got the Dagon. Brown boots, Dagon blink. As Chen picks up a mech, much more reasonable, standard, expected item.
That's, I mean, and he's going to be level 11 soon as one. I'm pretty sure with the level 2 Finger, plus the Earth Spike and the Dagon, he's, as you said, he's going to solo almost any hero.
Yeah. So, not going to be very fun. I don't really feel like he's in that much, I mean, he dies at bottom lane, but that's kind of unrelated to like how a typical fight will play out. With the Blink Dagger, he can choose his timing to enter the fight. You've got enough frontline initiators in the form of the Beastmaster. The Juggernaut who has Blade Fury can even stand on the front lines to some extent, so you've got the Chen heals to back up these cores, so he's in a position where he can almost always guarantee getting all these spells off, taking out one hero, possibly disabling a second or a third, so Lion can get a lot done. Olympavos drums up, he goes aggressive and Well, the Static Storm Havos gets out of it. He still beat up the Omni Slash. He goes for the Blade Fury instead. Will save his life and decides to go defensive rather than aggressive. It's YOLO going aggressive here. Finds one. Can he get any secondary kills with the Ensnare? The Centaur stun. It's on cooldown, but here comes Lion, and Iron Man will be able to look to secure this kill. His finger won't need it, and Iron Man actually gets the... Okay, doesn't need it because he can just right-click to get the last hit for the kill.
Yeah, he opened up his Dagon in the Tusk, who died shortly after in that fight as yep. well. And I was thinking, I mean, you can solo kill people with, you know, your stun into double nuke combo, but another way of looking at it is that Lion's a hero early on.
Speak of Lion, look at this skill build. No mana drain, max stats? He's actually going to be tanky and have a pretty decent sized mana pool, although he doesn't have the mana regen. This is something different from Iron Man.
Well, he's going for this. He's going for the solo kill.
Yeah,
this is the play.
Has he got the mana for it? He doesn't have the Dagon. He has just the finger. It's going to be enough, though.
Doesn't need it.
He did
yeah,
the
what
math.
I want to say is maybe the reason is not that you want to use both. It's that you want to be able to combo people more often.
Yes.
So stun into Dagon or stun into LT, and you're both available.
Yeah. But the thing, finger always, especially level 1, finger has a long cooldown, and until you get level 3, it doesn't really get that short cooldown, so... Finds a Phoenix pickoff, and even though he's not here for this push, there's no Phoenix here, so taking out that Phoenix takes away one of the most important kind of heroes for the Avengers defense, and Fantastic Five, Aegis in hand, they're gonna continue this push. Iron Man's just off in No Man's Land, farming away, picked up some Arcane Boots, oh, OD ultimate bottom! BZZ not gonna get the kill though, gets a Banish off an Invoker, but they're gonna secure the Racks with this Healing Ward. Just sustaining the Fantastic Five side. They've got the Phoenix back here. He will go diving forward, but doesn't want to commit to a Supernova. Doesn't have the necessary backup. Black thinks about a blink forward, but hasn't got the Yules. Hasn't really got a setup here, so... Very easy hold. Oh, sorry, easy. As far as defensive retreat from Fantastic Five. And they commit in. They pick out the Egg. Blade Fury through. Havos has an Omni Slash as well. Looking for the Vision. Is he going to go for this one? Turns around. Changes his mind. Looking for Disruptor, but... Quickly realize that's not going to work out too well. Off to the side, it's going to be the Vrax being claimed by Fantastic Five. Roar out onto Solitude. They lose Jug. Oh, Havos. He was trying to go for the Omni Slash. Instead, he gets caught in the cooldown. And they're going to lose. Oh! BZZ blinked into that meatball. They take the Vrax, but they lose 4. Not the cleanest push.
This is what happens when they fight without Iron Man.
Yeah.
Their star player.
Who now is an Aether Lance? Oh my gosh, this Lion build. Coming to a pub game near you soon. If not by your teammates, it's going to be done by me, because this is something.
Yeah, it looks like fun.
It does! Cool. You just run around, taking kills, getting 10-minute blinks, telling your fellow support, hey, I'm not buying support items, I'm not buying wards, I'm going to farm my Dagon.
Yeah.
But yeah, a bit of a messy push coming out from Fantastic Five. Not that it, I think, ultimately matters.
It's a big chunk of gold. I mean, it's a big chunk of gold back to Avengers. It's... Like, it probably doesn't matter for the bigger picture, but it is totally unnecessary.
Yeah. I mean, you still look at the state of the game. You just lost a Rax at 20 minutes, and you're down 12k gold. Yes, you just got a big chunk of gold, but you take that aside, it's a terrible position to be in.
Yeah. And Beastmaster just finished Necro 3, which I feel like, you know, usually the Necro 3 is like... marks the timing of, okay, now we can push the Rax, they can't do anything about it, and they've already killed the side of Rax, and then they get the Necro 3, and that's just really kind of devastating. Well, Iron Man is going to try and sneak around and catch
him. I've been watching him. He's like just the silent hunter right now. He's very close to Yonis. Yonis is going to walk into him. Oh, no. Oh. Can they get the return kill? He could blink out if he can get away from this gyrocopter. Nope, he can't get away from the gyrocopter. Ran the wrong direction. Ran himself into a little cage.
Yeah.
And...
It was like the worst possible round it could be, but he didn't really know, I suppose.
No. If he runs further left, Gyrocopter can just drop the cooldown as well, if he's worried about getting fogged.
But it doesn't matter. It's almost, I mean, despite... Like,
it's an 800 Lion's... kill bounty, but still, it really doesn't matter.
Like, Lion is fourth on the net worth, and is worth like twice the value of Phoenix, but I still feel like if Lion just spent the rest of the game dying to solo kill Phoenix, that'll probably be enough for his team. Like, he doesn't really need to contribute more than that.
No. At some point, his team's probably like, okay, you're having your fun, but let's, like, come join us for when we go for this push, because I feel like he does offer more when he groups up as five rather than finding these solo pickoffs. It was cute
it's
the first time, but... Yeah, it really is, it really is.
You pick one player on the enemy team, and you like just kill them over and over and over, and you're hoping that they'll tilt and then like affect their team's mentality. I mean, yep. This Phoenix is 0-8, and from that first mid fight where RMN caught him out before he could even ulti, I just feel like If you're Yonas in this game, like, Lion is your worst nightmare. You can be like, seeing Lion in your sleep tonight, like, why is this hero always catching me out and killing me?
Well, Avengers at least still holding their own, despite being down a rack. Have got, I mean, you got Gyrocopter in your team, one of the better heroes for defending and pushing out some of these lanes at times, but seems Fantastic Five are slowing things down. I'm looking around, like, wondering what exactly they might be waiting for. They've got BZZ on the OD, waiting for a BKB, but still a decent amount of ways from it. Jug has a Yasha, so either a Manta or a SMY coming out. Possibly the next Roche is the other kind of consideration as well.
Yeah. It's almost certainly the next Roche, I think. I think that they'll be more than happy to like, guarantee a 5v5 fight at the Roche, but alternatively, just get a free Aegis and then push with it. And in the meantime, Armin's actually now gone for a gem, which uncharacteristic for this game, but he's gonna just clear off the map and make sure that he's safe when he's wandering around.
Has a hawk to protect him, yeah.
Yeah,
just look where he's
pretty incredible.
You see where he is on the map with a gem. That's the crazy thing. He's off on his own, roaming onto the enemy jungle, past it. No problem. This is, I mean, it's not even like kind of risky. It's not even that risky. Like when you see that he's got the hawk, that he's got, like, he knows exactly what he's doing.
Yep, and
they're hunting RMN. It's the smoke to try and catch RMN, but unfortunately he's already left the dire jungle. They knew he was up there earlier, so they're really trying to figure out where he went to, but Fantastic Five smoking themselves.
Yeah, they're gonna catch them.
This looks really
Avengers have to win this fight to stay in the game, I think.
But doing so, it looks very difficult. The Hulk will scout them out. They catch a lot of heroes here. They're gonna find the Disruptor. Roar goes onto the Invoker. They'll split their efforts on the Disruptor as well as Invoker. The fall damage, and they'll get the finger from afar. Not quite enough to kill him off, but it takes him out of the fight. Omni Slash coming through now. Solitude getting low. Bladery on through the egg. It pops and actually stuns Havos, preventing some of that chase here. Ghostic goes down to the right clicks here, gets ensnared up. Still gonna try lifesteal his way through this one, and the Sunstrike. Oop. Nope, not gonna catch a kill here. OD, one more blink. Okay, it's gonna be the Mana Burn. The long-range Mana Burn snipes Gyrocopter, takes out 4 in the end, and with the Healing Ward sustain, this push will continue. There's just too much sustain more than anything. You've got Hand of God, Mech. That fight, not perfectly executed by Fantastic Five, but there's no way Avengers could punish them.
Yeah, honestly, it was a bit of a mess from Fantastic Five, but just shows how far ahead they are that it works out anyway.
Amen. Target of the aggression, but gets forced away. Has a homing missile following him. Gets bonked. The Sunstrike. Hello. Goodbye. And they're gonna catch BZZ as well. So Avengers can claim this gem here if they realize it's there. And I believe Black. Nope. He's gonna go blinking past it. Doesn't seem like they're okay. No. Disruptor's got it. He's made aware of it at least. And we'll pick it up and base held. Okay.
No, it's only told you to bot back. Honestly, that's just very, very sloppy from Fantastic Five, and looks like Yol might go down.
Yep. Boss, can you turn this one around? Blade Fury, gonna guess wrong as far as the direction Black retreated, and Black is gonna turn. Invoker's not gonna go for any kind of a play there. So Black has the Ag Scepter, level 16, level 17 now.
Hasn't died yet this game.
This is a hero that scales very well into the late game, and already the most farmed here in the game, level 17. I've got to imagine that's, the highest level here in the game by a decent margin as well. So
this is a point where I think if you're Fantastic Five, you need to, someone on the team needs to say, guys, the game's not over yet, you can still lose, let's focus. Because that's why I feel like that those two sequences of fights at the top lane are just them acting far too cocky with their lead, and they end up giving away a gem, they give up a lot of kills, and the Gyro's big, the Invoker's big, and they need to recognize that they're still very definitely ahead, but, you know, the game's not going to win itself. RMN does kill Tusk this time. Solo kill with his full combo.
Ouch. We missed that one, but probably better for the viewer's sake. didn't sound too
fun. Yeah, I mean, he blinked in and cast the 3 spell, he stunned and double nuked. That's, you didn't have to see it, really.
Can imagine. Can picture how that one went down. So, and you look at this Avengers side, they've got 3 heroes all very poor, but a hero like Phoenix, you've got level 2 ultimate. Like, it's much more about what landing your spells and having items on this hero. There's some items which are nice to have, but you can make do without. Similar for, like, Disruptor and even Tufts. Like, if you just land your spells, get up a good save with the Snowball, get a good Static Storm, these heroes can still have a big impact.
They're going to try Contest. I don't know if they're going to be on time.
It looks like they're a little late. Voss. Someone get the Aegis. Okay, BZZ picks it up. They'll take out the Ford Spirits, and like you say, they're just there a little bit too late. The Sunray very low. Yeah, level 1 Sunray. Not the build we've been used to see. It is a Core Phoenix, but if you leave it on the Core Phoenix, it's been... We've seen a decent amount of just Sunray leveled up early.
Yeah, I also feel like maxing your spirits in this game is a bit strange, considering the fact that the biggest threat to your egg is the Jag, who can just spin them off anyway. And even level 1 spirits kind of slow the attack speed quite substantially.
I mean, to be honest, Dive's on a spell. It gives you a bit of extra damage, but it's not really a spell you need to level up anyways.
Yeah, sure. I mean, neither of them, right? I feel like you max the Sunray ahead of either of them in this game.
And like if you're doing really well and, kind of snowballing, yeah, you get your Dive Fire Spirits because you know you're going to get lots of levels, but you're basically in support status right now. You're not going to max Sunray for some time, so at this stage, Dive is just not a threat, the damage it gives you.
Yep.
Sunray scales just amazingly well. That's just such a good spell.
Look at RMN. Yeah. Just look at him.
Pops a ward, waiting for a kill. He's having fun. Blinks forward even. Oh my gosh, this guy's insane. He gets the ward in the high ground. And there will be an Invoker nearby. He's got 2k HP. He can actually survive the combo. Black, very tanky with this Aghanim's into Octarine build that he's going for.
We still haven't really seen a devastating Necro 3 push. Remember, the first set of racks was before the Necro 3s, and since then there's been kind of sloppy engagements and execution from the side of Fantastic Five, but they did get another Aegis now, and they've got the BKB finish on the OD, they've got the Manta and the Diffusal Blade and the Jagger, and they've got all the tools they need to close up the game if they, you know, approach it, I think, a bit more seriously than they did the previous time at the top lane. On the flip side, if they manage to lose a fight and then Voker or the Gyro survive through the fight, it's actually very, very big for Avengers.
I think that's actually one of the byproducts of what Lion and RMN's been doing. Less about it being a bad play, but it just creates this kind of clowny atmosphere to the game, which sometimes leads to those situations where your teammates will take a bad fight or just end up messing things up because of just the game feeling like a pub game, as you kind of mentioned. It's a very pub-style play that we're seeing coming out from RMN. Not that it's bad play by any means.
Yeah, I totally agree. The whole team's probably laughing and enjoying how well his strategy's working. Well, they're gonna go up the high ground and force to spin the way back.
Glimpse back from onto RMN. Not sure if that was the intended result, but let's see what will come out. They're gonna look to keep going forward. The Necro 3s have already been summoned, but not easy to push. RMN goes in, immediately deletes Disruptor, but has he got an escape plan? He's gonna get banished, and he's forced the initiation from Avengers. Boogie goes down next. Solitude in some trouble, getting sliced apart by Havos. Doesn't quite go down. He's got the armor he needs to survive at the Blade Fury. Ghost Stick, no roar, but the OD drops the bomb, and they take out a third here. The Egg, not going to be dealt with here. They back off instead. Yol, his heal's already on cooldown. He's already committed them. Healing Ward, not available for the time being. Phoenix drops a lot of Fire Spirits. The Sunray as well die. BZZ banishes himself and stays alive as a result. Nope, Tornado. For a second it looked mistimed, but it actually managed to just clip BZZ, who still has the Aegis, so ultimately not a kill that Black wants to die for. Manta out, and Black will blink back to safety. Nice control coming out from Black. Keeps this top lane alive for now.
Yeah, I mean, it's... So in the bigger picture, it's a win for Avengers because they hold, but I don't think they really necessarily win the fight. They didn't get rid of the Aegis, they did lose their Gyrocopter, and I think the approach that Fantastic Five used there is actually probably the correct approach. Just start with the Lion deleting someone, and it doesn't even matter if the Lion lives after that. It depends, I suppose. If he were to delete someone who can buy back and then he dies, that's going to be a very bad value.
Yeah, I guess, but that's where Disruptor is kind of don't expect a Disruptor to have buyback at this stage.
Yeah, and RMN actually just upgrades his Dagon. He's just yep. I'm going to make sure I can keep deleting people. And I mean, I like it. I actually, this item gets a bit too much hate. I think analytically, the real weakness of the item is what it gives you for how much it costs and what you might have instead, like a 4-staff or Glimmer Cape. But I think if you're already in the situation where you're at that gold level, you're affording Dagon levels. And
yeah.
The upgrades are actually very valuable. It's not just the more damage, you get more stats, you get shorter cooldown, you get... just those two things. But those are two... I think you also get better cost range. Sorry, yeah. That's
it's very much typically looked at hey, you're a support. There's so many different utility items you can get. You look at the mech, or you look at the 4-staff, the glimmer cape, the blink dagger as initiation. And that's where you don't normally think, oh, support, you just want single target DPS. That's only a role filled by more your carries. But Like in a game where you've already got the sustain of the Chen, you've got some defensive counterplays from Roar, from the OD banish, so I think given the situation, like you say, it very much has its merits as an item.
Well, the Aegis has timed out.
Yeah. So, in some ways, I mean, you talk about it not being the best hold for Avengers because the Aegis was still there. It was a hold in the sense that the Aegis will expire before another push can come. And Fantastic Five have to kind of figure out what the next plan is going to be. OD's picked up a Mystic Staff, so can transition into either a Sheepstick or a Shiver's Guard from here, and it does feel like they've hit a bit of a brick wall as far as being able to end this game. I'm not too concerned, like, I wouldn't be too concerned for them yet, but they do need to find a way to break this base at some point.
Yeah, economically they're only getting further and further ahead, but in terms of the flow, it is quite a big deal that they weren't able to just, you know, like, you could say that they were a bit clowny the first time. The second time they took it more seriously and thought, okay, well, now that we're serious, it'll work, and they still got kind of rebuffed, and maybe the Invoker is just the key. At some point, you just look at the game, and you're like, we've never killed this hero, and we're struggling to, like, achieve what we're trying to do. Maybe what we need to do is kill the hero, and that's the hero that's, you know, making the biggest impact, stopping us, slowing us down.
It's not going to be easy. I feel even if they recognize and say, okay, Lion, take him out. He's got 2.1k HP. It's not an easy kill. You've got Tusk, who can snowball to save him as well, so...
Yeah, I think Lion can almost do it. I mean, that's a frightening thing, but Lion is level 16 with the Dagon 2 and Aetherlands, and I think Lion can almost solo that then.
So what are you, like, 850, another 500, you're looking at 1300. It's still a bit of a way. Like, he's got about 1600 damage, and that's before magic reduction, so... It's...
Wait, but are you including the Aetherlands?
Oh, yeah, that's true. Okay, so... And with the Aetherlands, it probably ends up being around, like, 1500 damage total output.
Yeah. So you'd need, like, one or two hits from the OD as well, or something like that.
Okay, I mean, I guess Beastmaster's got Blink now, so very much... If you get him with a Blink Roar, you go in, and you go hard onto that Invoker. And you've got to try and deal with the Tusk counterplay.
The real combo, the Chen Penitence, that's what you need. Penitence on Invoker and then just nuke him down.
Well,
here it is.
I got him. Finger. Havos goes for the Omni Slash, and like you say, they make sure they take him out. They recognize that he is one of the big kills to get. Iron Man getting a bit low here. Doesn't have to worry about a Sunstrike. Actually gets a Healing Ward to help him out, and they've caught a Banish here. Who's this on? It's on Shaq on the Disruptor, and he's going to waddle back to safety. So they should be able to force the Invoker buyback here, it looks like, and it's a pretty big loss for Avengers.
The tricky thing, right? So they've used Omni Slash, they've used Lion Ulti. I mean, Lion Ulti has a short cooldown, but he's got low mana. And the tricky thing here is that some of the value of heroes like Disrupt and Tusk, if Invoker buys back, you're not going to be able to just get out. Like,
Someone's
going to be glimpsed. Someone's going to be glimpsed.
Well, there's a Roar in the mid lane. Goes down to Solitude. Don't see a glimpse coming out yet. There we go. They've got the Lion of Iron Man. He gets banished up. Can he get the Blink out? He makes. He'll be able to survive this one. Blink. Iron Man, no. It's immediately caught out by the Phoenix Fire Spirit and taken out.
It's a minor advantage of these kinds of chase heroes that isn't talked about that often, but it makes it harder to force buybacks. I mean, I think that it's worth it for Fantastic Five anyway to use the Lion to force the Invoker's buyback, because if they kill the Invoker again, they'll probably just end the game. But it is, like, sometimes you get in that situation, you kill an important hero, you want to force the buyback, but because of the composition the team has, if he does buyback, they're almost certainly going to get value for it. And
well, value to the extent it's just a Lion kill. Like, you've got Jug who can Blade Fury away, who can always dodge the glimpse. Like, most of the heroes, you've got BKB on OD, so most of the heroes who are important to you can actually get away from that catch.
Yeah, that's true. I think that's probably the kind of thing they're thinking when they go for it anyway, and I'm pretty sure that they're more than happy with giving up their land for the buyback.
They got a buyback. They also forced out the glyph there with Juggernaut. I like how they treated it, because they're worried about the buyback. They had the creep wave pushing mid, and Jug just goes in for, like, the backdoor play in the top lane, recognizing that, oh, there's probably going to be no one there. I have my Manta, I have my Blade Fury. I'm in a pretty good defensive position, so... Havos, very farmed at this stage. Actually goes into the Butterfly. And not something Jaro can counterplay anytime soon. He's building into a Butterfly of his own with 3.5k gold. Could change it up and say, I want MKB instead, but Havos is just looking very, very potent on this draft.
And Rush respawns, Chen creeps, there to scout it, and there's immense pressure on Black right now at this stage in the game. What? They see Havos, they might attempt to lock him down here, I'm not sure how.
Gets an Ice Shards catch, and Buki can keep him in place with the War is punched. They get the Static Storm. Havos, very low, might go down here. Is there going to be a Chen save? Nope, he's not. Supernova comes in, helping to protect this the Avengers side. Odie drops the hammer. Gets just one kill, but the stun gonna catch him from the Supernova as he lands, and OD on the back foot now. BKB wears off, and Solitude chasing Blink forward from Blackwall. Catch him with the Cold Snap, and there's gonna be an immediate banish. Look, impales there, he blinks back to safety. Nicely played by BZZ. Sunstrike catches him black! Snipes him down, great Sunstrike. Precision coming out, and they get four kills off of it. And they could actually take Roshan here. That would probably be the biggest part of this for Avengers. They're less concerned about pushing anymore. They just want Rosh, and they're gonna scout it out. Solitude's already in the pit. He sees this, and what a disaster for Fantastic Five.
Yeah, and it's, like, I hate to say it, but, well, actually, I mean, it's honestly, that's 100% Havoc's fault. There's, like, there's no discussion to be had about that. He wanders on his own into, like, the whole enemy team. He's got a lot of ways to live. He spins away, gets a bit caught by the shards, and, I mean, I think even dying there is not the end of the world if he gets his Omni Slash off first, but he manages to get caught by the Glimpse into the Disruptor combo. Like,
and it's like your whole team, like, goes in after you, like, oh, let's save Havoc. It's not just like a Havoc dies and then I don't even think they lose Roche with Havoc dead necessarily. He can potentially buy back, or I think Avengers may just be too scared to go for it, but they lose a terrible fight because everyone wants to save it.
So I don't know what the communication's like, but Havoc needed to be saying there, guys, I completely screwed up, don't come in, I'm dead, leave me. And if he wasn't saying those things, which I think he probably wasn't, because the kind of player he is, then it's just totally on him. They lose the fight, they lose the rush, and Avengers are actually coming back into the game as a result of that, mostly just that single play.
Yeah, I mean, up until then, there'd been very small victories, like holding the top racks for some time, waiting out the Aegis, but it was never things that really gained ground for Avengers. It was just like, okay, they stalled out the game. Now they can look to make their next play. But that was the first play where it's like, whoa, Avengers, huge victory, big gold swing, and not just like in terms of net worth, but strategically, they've got the Aegis on their side. They can now pick up the butterfly on Solitude on the Gyrocopter. They've got a big amount of farm on these two great late-game carries in Gyrocopter and Invoker, and that's going to be somewhat scary and worrying for the Fantastic Five side.
Yeah, honestly, right before that happened, I was about to point out that there's a huge pressure on Black because his buyback's cooling down. It still is cooling down. That's how much has happened in the last few minutes since he did buyback, but the pressure is just off his shoulders. There was going to be a lot of pressure on him because of the buyback cooldown. If he died again, they'd lose. And now I think if he dies, the game just, you know, they don't. His team doesn't necessarily just lose if he dies.
And his team are looking to try and pose some pressure here towards this top lane. Ward's placed down to kind of protect the dire jungle of Avengers, and they'll snipe the Hawk with an Ice Shards and leave Solitude in this top lane to continue farming.
I mean, do you remember there was a time in this game, probably about 10 minutes, maybe 15 minutes ago, where I was saying Lion had double the net worth of Phoenix, and now they're very close. Wow. It's about 1,000 gap between the two of them. The Phoenix has managed to come all the way back up, get level 16, get a Shiva's Guard. This was a 0-8 Phoenix. I think at that stage had 3 assists. Now it's 2-9 and 11. Really gotten more into the game. There's been quite a few successful eggs, and the Shiva's is going to make it even easier to make the egg successful.
The courier respawns, and that was some. I think that was the Hex at BZZ, which I believe he may have, he didn't have in that previous fight because the crew was dead, I want to say. But
right now, I think so, yeah.
Both teams playing defense. It doesn't look like Avengers are going to get much out of this Aegis, but I mean, the biggest thing they get out of it is denying it from Fantastic Five, because holding an Aegis cheese push, even just fighting into that, would be damn near impossible. So denying it from Fantastic Five, more important than what they can get out of it. Because kind of like you said, Invoker still has no buyback, so they don't want to play too aggressive. We're on Jonas
gets
not a big loss, but again, it's not been the best game for Jonas.
It's just interesting to me because I almost feel like drawing out the game might be better for Avengers psychologically, even though I don't think that they outscale. I think that in the very late game, Fantastic Five look really good, actually. But just psychologically, the way that the game's gone, okay, there's a blink in, there's a hex, and that's another pickoff. Just the way the game's gone, where Fantastic Five thought the game was so easy, and like they were messing around, doing fun things, laughing about it, and then slowly but surely things start turning on them. I feel like if that game gets drawn out, then you're the team that feels like you had it in the bag so long ago. Yep. That can like get into your head.
I definitely agree. If it looks to me on paper like Fantastic Five scale fine into the late game, like they're gonna have, almost want to say like the better late game lineup, but yeah, psychologically it gets trickier. Just having Beast, like the vision advantage from the Beastmaster Hawk, is such an important thing in the late game. We'll See how Voss frontlining it here. Does not have a way to deal with the evasion. Just gets hexed up. He's been... Oh, okay. Banish will save him for now as Sunstrike is going to be waiting for him. Black does not get the timing. And Havos, he gets off the Omnislash with the BKB. He goes marching forward. The Omnislash is going to clean up here. Mantis onto Solitude. Can he get the kill? Healing Ward gets taken out. Solitude. He's got the Aegis though. Jonas marches forward. Drops a Fire Spirit with a Supernova. They're losing the top racks, though. Beastmaster's going for the backdoor play, and that's the melee racks of all things as well. Ghostick looks like he may pay for this one. This life gets banished, but that means the OD himself is going to go down. BZZ in trouble. They lose one. They're going to lose a second in Ghostick unless he gets the TP up, which he will. Ooh, narrowly gets himself out of there. Havos surviving as well.
Yeah, it's a messy fight. It's a small win for Fantastic Five. They do kill another Rax. They get rid of the Aegis, which was going to time out quite soon. They're still going to probably lose their chain up here at the top. I'm not sure. Yeah, he doesn't have a TP. If he had a TP, he could have...
Level 3 homing missile could be close. Ooh. I think he should have waited for the missile to land with that Sunstrike, perhaps. I think he may survive this one. Even has a mech. Okay. Oh, chases on off to the side. Tusk snowballing forward. Boogie looking for RMN. Won't get the kill. Okay, they did end up losing the Chen to the Phoenix dive forward.
What a fight Avengers could have had if Black hit his Deafening Blast and Sunstrike
well,
right after that.
He had the insta BKB, so I don't think he could hit the Sunstrike. That's
The Sunstrike probably would have killed him.
I think so too. The Deafening Blast was never going to land with the insta BKB, but yeah, if he hit that Sunstrike, I believe he gets that kill, and then I think Avengers just straight up win that fight convincingly. Now Volos walks into a Static Storm, BKB's out of it. Which looks like it will spell the... won't spell the death of anime immediately. Gets defused up, then gets taken out. Havos, we're going to charge forward and find more. Jonas going to be on the receiving end of this one. Has the dive. Gets a little bit further away. Havos, not going to chase. Recognizing his limits, perhaps, and elsewhere. Boogie, getting Dagon, getting impaled, taken out. The Chen, Granite Golem. Says,
and Black does
get
have
you
his,
gone, and they take him out.
Black's got his super deafening blast online.
Is it going to be enough to hold, though? They've already lost the melee Rex in the top lane. They don't want to lose this mid lane. And without a glyph there, T3 tower just getting chipped away at. Sunstrike will take out the Necrobook. The Supernova used very early and very defensively. RMN won't get taken out here on the retreat, but it's the mid lane where they've lost the T3 tower. Rex is exposed. The boss could just go forward and try to focus the Rex. There's no play for you for now, but they take out Gyro. He's got no buyback. Havos gets the Omni Slash off, takes out Phoenix and the Necrobooks, and it looks like this is the end. Yep, no buyback on Gyro. They call it. It was not the cleanest finish, but Fantastic Five, they had the lead from the start, and they managed to secure themselves a 2-0 victory here.
Yeah, I'm quite impressed by Fantastic Five. I feel like the hiccups in this game were mostly because they like lost their own composure, and that's something in the long run they could deal with. Avengers probably need to put a lot more work in finding a sense of direction as a team. What kind of drafts they want to go for and how they want to progress throughout the game, understanding like at different stages of the game what each player needs to be doing, where they want to be going, because I think that they still as a team look quite undefined.
Yeah, and that's what I kind of take away from this series and even this game too, like Fantastic Five, a team to really look out for, who could be one of the top contenders, even though this game too was a game that wasn't played well for them, at least past the 20-25 minute mark. Strategically, everything, the execution in the early game, all the decision making, all the direction was on point. And there, you look at this game, like, they should have stomped it. They didn't because of bad plays, but that's something they can easily rein back in and kind of control for and work on for future games.
Yeah, I totally agree. I'm just wondering is RMN going to always be playing like Lina Lion, something that can like zap people down, or like maybe that's something to look out for in future, like, because I think as meta games evolve, you usually can't have a player who only plays like one kind of support. He might have to play, you know, a Dazzle or something defensive at some points, and maybe that's an aspect of the game that still has to be examined, because we just don't know. But he's certainly done brilliantly on these two supports.
Yeah. Well, strong showing from Fantastic Five. They'll advance to the next round, where they will be versing Team Ad Finem, who's been one of the kind of tougher opponents who's been on the rise in the European scene as of late. But that game not going to be played for a couple of days. Up next, we've got Team Alternate versus Elements. Take a bit of a break, guys, and we'll come back. I believe that match is scheduled to start in about 1 hour's time. So there'll be a bit of a break. Unless the match moves up, I'll let you guys know. But for now, Starlight Invitational continues after this.